This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Capitalism is an economic system based on private ownership of the means of production and their operation for profit. Characteristics central to capitalism include private property, capital accumulation, wage labor, voluntary exchange, a price system, and competitive markets. In a capitalist market economy, decision making and investment is determined by the owners of the factors of production in financial and capital markets, and prices and the distribution of goods are mainly determined by competition in the market. Economists, political economists, and historians have adopted different perspectives in their analyses of capitalism and have recognized various forms of it in practice. These include laissez-faire or free market capitalism, welfare capitalism, and state capitalism. Different forms of capitalism feature varying degrees of free markets, public ownership, obstacles to free competition, and state-sanctioned social policies. The degree of competition in markets, the role of intervention and regulation, and the scope of state ownership vary across different models of capitalism. Capitalism, the extent to which different markets are free, as well as the rules defining private property, are matters of politics and of policy. Most existing capitalist economies are mixed economies, which combine elements of free markets with state intervention, and in some cases, with economic planning. Capitalism has existed under many forms of government, in many different times, places, and cultures. Following the decline of mercantilism, mixed capitalist systems became dominant in the Western world and continue to spread. Contents 1. Etymology 2. History 21. Agrarian capitalism 22. Mercantilism 23. Industrial capitalism 24. Modern capitalism 241. Relationship to democracy 3. Characteristics 31. Summary 32. The market 33. Profit motive 34. Private property 35. Market competition 36. Reserve army of labor 361. Composition of the relative surplus population 37. As a mode of production 4. Wage labor 41. Types 42. Comparison to slavery 5. Systemic weaknesses 51. Externalities 52. Anti-competitive practices 6. Capital accumulation 61. Background 62. Concentration and centralization 63. The rate of accumulation 64. The circuit of capital accumulation from production 65. Simple and expanded reproduction 66. Capital accumulation as social relation 7. Supply and demand 71. Graphical representation of supply and demand 711. Supply schedule 712. Demand schedule 72. Equilibrium 73. Partial equilibrium 74. Empirical estimation 75. Macroeconomic uses of demand and supply 76. History 8. Capitalism and war 9. Types of capitalism 91. Advanced capitalism 92. Finance capitalism 93. Mercantilism 94. Free market economy 95. Social market economy 96. State capitalism 97. Corporate capitalism 98. Mixed economy 99. Others 10. Role of government 101. Adverse characteristics of capitalist governments 11. Criticism 111. Profit motive 112. Marxian responses 113. Supply and demand 114. Counter-criticisms 1141. Austrian school 1142. Ayn Rand 115. Economic growth 12. Economic freedom 13. See also 14. References 15. Further reading 16. External links. Etymology. Other terms sometimes used for capitalism: capitalist mode of production, economic individualism, economic liberalism, free enterprise, free enterprise economy, free market economy, laissez-faire market economy, market liberalism, modified free enterprise, neoliberalism, self-regulating market, profits system. The term capitalist, meaning an owner of capital, appears earlier than the term capitalism. It dates back to the mid-17th century. Capitalist is derived from capital, which evolved from capitale, a late Latin word based on caput, meaning head, also the origin of chattel and cattle in the sense of movable property, only much later to refer only to livestock. Capitale emerged in the 12th to 13th centuries in the sense of referring to funds, stock of merchandise, sum of money, or money carrying interest. By 1283 it was used in the sense of the capital assets of a trading firm. It was frequently interchanged with a number of other words. wealth, money, funds, goods, assets, property, and so on. The Hollandish Mercurius uses capitalists in 1633 and 1654 to refer to owners of capital in French. Étienne Clavier referred to capitalistes in 1788, 6 years before its first recorded English usage by Arthur Young in his work Travels in France 1792. David Ricardo, in his Principles of Political Economy and Taxation 1817, referred to the capitalist many times. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, an English poet, used capitalist in his work Table Talk 1823. Pierre-Joseph Proudhon used the term capitalist in his first work, What is Property 1840, to refer to the owners of capital. Benjamin Disraeli used the term capitalist in his 1845 work Sybil. The initial usage of the term capitalism in its modern sense has been attributed to Louis Blanc in 1850, what I call capitalism, that is to say the appropriation of capital by some to the exclusion of others, and Pierre-Joseph Proudhon in 1861, economic and social regime in which capital, the source of income, does not generally belong to those who make it work through their labor. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels referred to the capitalistic system and to the capitalist mode of production in Das Kapital 1867. The use of the word capitalism in reference to an economic system appears twice in Volume 1 of Das Kapital, p. Capitalist mode of production, which appear more than 2,600 times in the trilogy Das Kapital. According to the Oxford English Dictionary OED, the term capitalism first appeared in English in 1854 in the novel The Newcomes, by novelist William Makepeace Thackeray, where he meant having ownership of capital. Also according to the OED, Carl Adolf Douay, a German-American socialist and abolitionist, used the phrase private capitalism in 1863 History main article, History of Capitalism. Capital has existed incipiently on a small scale for centuries, in the form of merchant, renting and lending activities, and occasionally as small-scale industry with some wage-labor simple commodity exchange, and consequently simple commodity production, which are the initial basis for the growth of capital from trade, have a very long history. The capitalistic era, according to Karl Marx, dates from 16th-century merchants and small urban workshops. Marx knew that wage-labor existed on a modest scale for centuries before capitalist industry. Early Islam promulgated capitalist economic policies, which migrated to Europe through trade partners from cities such as Venice. Capitalism in its modern form can be traced to the emergence of agrarian capitalism and mercantilism in the Renaissance. Thus, for much of history, capital and commercial trade existed, but it did not lead to industrialization or dominate the production process of society that required a set of conditions, including specific technologies of mass production, the ability to independently and privately own and trade in means of production, a class of workers willing to sell their labor power for a living, a legal framework promoting commerce, a physical infrastructure allowing the circulation of goods on a large scale, and security for private accumulation. Many of these conditions do not currently exist in many third world countries, although there is plenty of capital and labor. Thus, the obstacles for the development of capitalist markets are less technical and more social, cultural and political. Agrarian capitalism. The economic foundations of the feudal agricultural system began to shift substantially in 16th century England. The manorial system had broken down, and land began to become concentrated in the hands of fewer landlords with increasingly large estates. Instead of a serf-based system of labor, workers were increasingly employed as part of a broader and expanding money-based economy. The system put pressure on both landlords and tenants to increase the productivity of agriculture to make profit. The weakened coercive power of the aristocracy to extract peasant surpluses encouraged them to try better methods, and the tenants also had incentive to improve their methods, in order to flourish in a competitive labor market. Terms of rent for land were becoming subject to economic market forces rather than to the previous stagnant system of custom and feudal obligation. By the early 17th century, England was a centralized state in which much of the feudal order of medieval Europe had been swept away. This centralization was strengthened by a good system of roads and by a disproportionately large capital city. London, the capital, acted as a central market hub for the entire country, creating a very large internal market for goods, contrasting with the fragmented feudal holdings that prevailed in most parts of the continent. Mercantilism main article, Mercantilism, a painting of a French seaport from 1638 at the height of Mercantilism. mercantilism, the economic doctrine prevailing from the 16th to the 18th centuries, is commonly called mercantilism. This period, the Age of Discovery, was associated with the geographic exploration of the foreign lands by merchant traders, especially from England and the Low Countries. Mercantilism was a system of trade for profit. Although commodities were still largely produced by non-capitalist methods, most scholars consider the era of merchant capitalism and mercantilism as the origin of modern capitalism, although Karl Polanyi argued that the hallmark of capitalism is the establishment of generalized markets for what he called the fictitious commodities, land, labor, and money. Accordingly, he argued that not until 1834 was a competitive labor market established in England, hence industrial capitalism as a social system cannot be said to have existed before that date. Robert Clive. After the Battle of Plassey, the battle began. East India Company rule in India. England began a large-scale and integrative approach to mercantilism during the Elizabethan era 1558-1603. A systematic and coherent explanation of balance of trade was made public through Thomas Moon's argument. England's treasure by foreign trade, or the balance of our foreign trade, is the rule of our treasure. It was written in the 1620s and published in 1664. European merchants, backed by state controls, subsidies, and monopolies, made most of their profits by buying and selling goods. In the words of Francis Bacon, the purpose of mercantilism was the opening and well-balancing of trade, the cherishing of manufacturers, the banishing of idleness, the repressing of waste and excess by sumptuary laws, the improvement in husbanding of the soil, the regulation of prices. Revolution in Great Britain. In the mid-18th century, a new group of economic theorists, led by David Hume and Adam Smith, challenged fundamental mercantilist doctrines such as the belief that the world's wealth remained constant and that a state could only increase its wealth at the expense of another state. During the Industrial Revolution, industrialists replaced merchants as a dominant factor in the capitalist system and affected the decline of the traditional handicraft skills of artisans, guilds, and journeymen. Also during this period, the surplus generated by the rise of commercial agriculture encouraged increased mechanization of agriculture. Industrial capitalism marked the development of the factory system of manufacturing, characterized by a complex division of labor between and within work process and the routine of work tasks, and finally established the global domination of the capitalist mode of production. Britain also abandoned its protectionist policy, as embraced by mercantilism in the 19th century. Richard Cobden and John Bright, who based their beliefs on the Manchester School, initiated a movement to lower tariffs in the 1840s, Britain adopted a less protectionist policy. With the repeal of the Corn Laws and the Navigation Acts, Britain reduced tariffs and quotas, in line with David Ricardo's advocacy for free trade modern capitalism. The gold standard formed the financial basis of the international economy from 1870 to 1914. Capitalism was carried across the world by broader processes of globalization and, by the end of the 18th century, became the dominant global economic system, in turn intensifying processes of economic and other globalization later. In the 20th century, capitalism overcame a challenge by centrally planned economies and is now the encompassing system worldwide, with the mixed economy being its dominant form in the industrialized Western world. Industrialization allowed cheap production of household items using economies of scale, while rapid population growth created sustained demand for commodities. Globalization in this period was decisively shaped by 18th century imperialism. After the First and Second Opium Wars and the completion of British conquest of India, vast populations of these regions became ready consumers of European exports. Also in this period, areas of sub-Saharan Africa and the Pacific Islands were incorporated into the world system. Meanwhile, the conquest of new parts of the globe, notably sub-Saharan Africa, by Europeans yielded valuable natural resources such as rubber, diamonds and coal, and helped fuel trade and investment between the European imperial powers, their colonies, and the United States. The inhabitant of London could order by telephone, sipping his morning tea, the various products of the whole earth, and reasonably expect their early delivery upon his doorstep. Militarism and imperialism of racial and cultural rivalries were little more than the amusements of his daily newspaper. What an extraordinary episode in the economic progress of man was that age, which came to an end in August 1914. In this period, the global financial system was mainly tied to the gold standard. The United Kingdom first formally adopted this standard in 1821. Soon to follow were Canada in 1853, Newfoundland in 1865, the United States and Germany de jure in 1873. 1903 new technologies, such as the telegraph, the transatlantic cable, the radio telephone, the steamship and railway allowed goods and information to move around the world at an unprecedented degree. The New York Stock Exchange Traders Floor 1963. In the period following the global depression of the 1930s, the state played an increasingly prominent role in the capitalistic system throughout much of the world. The post-war boom ended in the late 1960s and early 1970s, and the situation was worsened by the rise of stagflation monetarism, a modification of Keynesianism that is more compatible with laissez-faire, gained increasing prominence in the capitalist world, especially under the leadership of Ronald Reagan in the US and Margaret Thatcher in the UK in the 1980s. Public and political interest began shifting away from the so-called collectivist concerns of Keynes's managed capitalism to a focus on individual choice, called remarketized capitalism relationship to democracy. Many analysts assert that China is one of the main examples of state capitalism in the 21st century. The relationship between democracy and capitalism is a contentious area in theory and in popular political movements. The extension of universal adult male suffrage in 19th century Britain occurred along with the development of industrial capitalism, and democracy became widespread at the same time as capitalism, leading capitalists to posit a causal or mutual relationship between them. However, in the 20th century, according to some authors, capitalism also accompanied a variety of political formations quite distinct from liberal democracies, including fascist regimes, absolute monarchies, and single-party states. Democratic peace theory asserts that democracies seldom fight other democracies, but critics of that theory suggest that this may be because of political similarity or stability rather than because they are democratic or capitalist. Moderate critics argue that though economic growth under capitalism has led to democracy in the past, it may not do so in the future, as authoritarian regimes have been able to manage economic growth without making concessions to greater political freedom. States with capitalistic economic systems have thrived under political regimes deemed to be authoritarian or oppressive. Singapore has a successful open market economy as a result of its competitive, business-friendly climate and robust rule of law. Nonetheless, it often comes under fire for one its brand of government, which, though democratic and consistently one of the least corrupt, operates largely under a one-party rule, and two not vigorously defending freedom of expression, given its government-regulated press, as well as penchant for upholding laws protecting ethnic and religious harmony, judicial dignity and personal reputation. The private capitalist sector in the People's Republic of China has grown exponentially and thrived since its inception, despite having an authoritarian government. Augusto Pinochet's rule in Chile led to economic growth and high levels of inequality by using authoritarian means to create a safe environment for investment and capitalism in capital in the 21st century. Thomas Piketty of the Paris School of Economics asserts that inequality is the inevitable consequence of economic growth in a capitalist economy, and the resulting concentration of wealth can destabilize democratic societies and undermine the ideals of social justice upon which they are built. Marxists, anarchists except for anarcho-capitalists, and other leftists argue that capitalism is incompatible with democracy, since capitalism, according to Marx, entails dictatorship of the bourgeoisie, owners of the means of production, while democracy entails rule by the people. Characteristics: capitalism is production for exchange, driven by the desire for personal accumulation of money receipts in such exchanges, mediated by free markets. The markets themselves are driven by the needs and wants of consumers and those of society as a whole. If these wants and needs were in the socialist or communist society envisioned by Marx, Engels and others the driving force, it would be production for use. Contemporary mainstream economics, particularly that associated with the right, holds that an invisible hand, through little more than the freedom of the market, is able to match social production to these needs and desires. Summary: in general, capitalism as an economic system and mode of production can be summarized by the following: capital accumulation, production for profit and accumulation as the implicit purpose of all or most of production, constriction or elimination of production formerly carried out on a common social or private household basis, commodity production, production for exchange on a market, to maximize exchange value instead of use value, private ownership of the means of production, high levels of wage labor, the investment of money to make a profit, the use of the price mechanism to allocate resources between competing uses, the market. The price P of a product is determined by a balance between production at each price supply, S, and the desires of those with purchasing power at each price demand, D. This results in a market equilibrium, with a given quantity Q sold of the product. A rise in demand would result in an increase in price and an increase in output in free market and laissez-faire forms of capitalism. Markets are used most extensively with minimal or no regulation over the pricing mechanism in mixed economies, which are almost universal today. Markets continue to play a dominant role but are regulated to some extent by government in order to correct market failures, promote social welfare, conserve natural resources, fund defense and public safety, or for other reasons. In state capitalist systems, markets are relied upon the least, with the state relying heavily on state-owned enterprises or in direct economic planning to accumulate capital supply as the amount of a good or service produced by a firm and which is available for sale. Demand is the amount that people are willing to buy at a specific price. Prices tend to rise when demand exceeds supply, and fall when supply exceeds demand. In theory, the market is able to coordinate itself when a new equilibrium price and quantity is reached. Competition arises when more than one producer is trying to sell the same or similar products to the same buyers. In capitalist theory, competition leads to innovation and more affordable prices. Without competition, a monopoly or cartel may develop. A monopoly occurs when a firm supplies the total output in the market. The firm can therefore limit output and raise prices because it has no fear of competition. A cartel is a group of firms that act together in a monopolistic manner to control output and raise prices. Profit motive. The profit motive is a theory in capitalism which posits that the ultimate goal of a business is to make money. Stated differently, the reason for a business's existence is to turn a profit. The profit motive functions on the rational choice theory, or the theory that individuals tend to pursue what is in their own best interests. Accordingly, businesses seek to benefit themselves and or their shareholders by maximizing profits. In capitalist theoretics, the profit motive is said to ensure that resources are being allocated efficiently. For instance, Austrian economist Henry Hazlitt explains, if there is no profit in making an article, it is a sign that the labor and capital devoted to its production are misdirected. The value of the resources that must be used up in making the article is greater than the value of the article itself. In other words, profits let companies know whether an item is worth producing. Theoretically, in free and competitive markets, maximizing profits ensures that resources are not wasted. Private property. The relationship between the state, its formal mechanisms, and capitalist societies has been debated in many fields of social and political theory, with active discussion since the 19th century. Hernando de Soto is a contemporary economist who has argued that an important characteristic of capitalism is the functioning state protection of property rights in a formal property system where ownership and transactions are clearly recorded. According to de Soto, this is the process by which physical assets are transformed into capital, which in turn may be used in many more ways and much more efficiently in the market economy. A number of Marxian economists have argued that the Enclosure Acts in England, and similar legislation elsewhere, were an integral part of capitalist primitive accumulation, and that specific legal frameworks of private land ownership have been integral to the development of capitalism. Market competition. Main article, competition economics. In capitalist economics, market competition is the rivalry among sellers trying to achieve such goals as increasing profits, market share, and sales volume by varying the elements of the marketing mix, price, product, distribution, and promotion. Merriam-Webster defines competition in business as the effort of two or more parties acting independently to secure the business of a third party by offering the most favorable terms. It was described by Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations 1776 and later economists as allocating productive resources to their most highly valued uses and encouraging efficiency. Smith and other classical economists before Cournot were referring to price and non-price rivalry among producers to sell their goods on best terms by bidding of buyers, not necessarily to a large number of sellers nor to a market in final equilibrium. Competition is widespread throughout the market process. It is a condition where buyers tend to compete with other buyers, and sellers tend to compete with other sellers. In offering goods for exchange, buyers competitively bid to purchase specific quantities of specific goods which are available, or might be available if sellers were to choose to offer such goods. Similarly, sellers bid against other sellers in offering goods on the market, competing for the attention and exchange resources of buyers. Competition results from scarcity. There is never enough to satisfy all conceivable human wants, and occurs when people strive to meet the criteria that are being used to determine who gets what. Reserve Army of Labor. Main article, Reserve reserve army of labor in a Marxist analysis of the capitalist economy. The reserve army of labor refers to the unemployed and underemployed. It is synonymous with industrial reserve army or relative surplus population, except that the unemployed can be defined as those actually looking for work and that the relative surplus population also includes people unable to work. The use of the word army refers to the workers being conscripted and regimented in the workplace in a hierarchy, under the commanding heights of the economy prior to the start of the capitalist era in human history, i.e. before the 1500s. Structural unemployment on a mass scale rarely existed, other than that caused by natural disasters and wars in ancient societies. All people who could work necessarily had to work, otherwise they would starve. A slave or a serf by definition could not become unemployed. There was normally very little possibility of earning a crust without working at all, and the usual attitude toward beggars and idlers was harsh. Children began to work already at a very early age indeed. The word employment is linguistically a product of the capitalist era. A permanent level of unemployment presupposes a working population which is to a large extent dependent on a wage or salary for a living, without having other means of livelihood, as well as the right of enterprises to hire and fire employees in accordance with commercial or economic conditions. The expression unemployed in English, in the sense of temporarily out of work, dates back to the 1660s. Reference to the unemployed as a group was first made in 1782, and reference to unemployment as a general condition is first attested in 1888. The first recorded discussion of the reserve army of labor is in a manuscript written by Karl Marx. Big industry constantly requires a reserve army of unemployed workers for times of overproduction. The main purpose of the bourgeois in relation to the worker is, of course, to have the commodity labor as cheaply as possible, which is only possible when the supply of this commodity is as large as possible in relation to the demand for it, i.e., when the overpopulation is the greatest. Overpopulation is therefore in the interest of the bourgeoisie, and it gives the workers good advice which it knows to be impossible to carry out, since capital only increases when it employs workers. The increase of capital involves an increase of the proletariat, and, as we have seen, according to the nature of the relation of capital and labor, the increase of the proletariat must proceed relatively even faster. The theory, which is also expressed as a law of nature, that population grows faster than the means of subsistence, is the more welcome to the bourgeois as it silences his conscience, makes hard-heartedness into a moral duty and the consequences of society into the consequences of nature, and finally gives him the opportunity to watch the destruction of the proletariat by starvation as calmly as other natural event without bestirring himself, and, on the other hand, to regard the misery of the proletariat as its own fault and to punish it. To be sure, the proletarian can restrain his natural instinct by reason, and so, by moral supervision, halt the law of nature in its injurious course of development. Karl Marx, Wages, December 1847. Marx introduced the concept in Chapter 25 of the first volume of Das Kapital, which states, "Capitalistic accumulation itself constantly produces, and produces in the direct ratio of its own energy and extent, a relatively redundant population of workers, i.e., a population of greater extent than suffices for the average needs of the valorization of capital, and therefore a surplus population. It is the absolute interest of every capitalist to press a given quantity of labor out of a smaller, rather than a greater number of laborers. If the cost is about the same, the more extended the scale of production, the stronger this motive. Its force increases with the accumulation of capital. His argument is that as capitalism develops, the organic composition of capital will increase, which means that the mass of constant capital grows faster than the mass of variable capital. Fewer workers can produce all that is necessary for society's requirements. In addition, capital will become more concentrated and centralized in fewer hands. This being the absolute historical tendency, part of the working population will tend to become surplus to the requirements of capital accumulation over time. Paradoxically, the larger the wealth of society, the larger the industrial reserve army will become. Marx called it the antagonism of capital accumulation, and he cites his The Poverty of Philosophy, Chapter 2, Section 1 to explain this phenomenon in relation with relations of production. One could add that the larger the wealth of society, the more people it can support who do not work. However, as Marx develops the argument further, it also becomes clear that, depending on the state of the economy, the Reserve Army of Labor will either expand or contract, alternately being absorbed or expelled from the employed workforce, thus taking them as a whole. The general movements of wages are exclusively regulated by the expansion and contraction of the Industrial Reserve Army, and these again correspond to the periodic changes of the industrial cycle. They are, therefore, not determined by the variations of the absolute number of the working population, but by the varying proportions in which the working class is divided into active and reserve army, by the increase or diminution in the relative amount of the surplus population, by the extent to which it is now absorbed, now set free. In recent years, there has been growing research on the concept of the precariat, to describe a growing reliance on temporary, part-time workers with precarious status, who share aspects of the proletariat and the reserve army of labor. Precarious workers do work part-time or full-time in temporary jobs, but they cannot really earn enough to live on, and depend partly on friends or family, or on state benefits, to survive. Typically they do not become truly unemployed, but they don't have a stable job to go to either. The rise of the precariat has been attributed to the emergence of global neoliberalism, although non-employed people who are unable or uninterested in performing legal paid work are not considered among the unemployed. The concept of conjunctural unemployment is used. In economics nowadays, economists often distinguish between short-term frictional or cyclical unemployment and longer-term structural unemployment. Sometimes there is a short-term mismatch between the demand and supply of labor. At other times there is much less total demand for labor than supply for a long time, if no possibility for getting a job at all in the foreseeable future exists. Many younger people decide to migrate or emigrate to a place where they can find work. Composition of the relative surplus population. Marx discusses the army of labor and the reserve army in Capital, ch. 25, section IV. The army of labor consists in those working class people employed in average or better than average jobs. Not everyone in the working class gets one of these jobs. There are then four other categories where members of the working class might find themselves: the stagnant pool, the floating reserves, the latent reserve, and pauperdom. Finally, people may leave the army and the reserve army by turning to criminality, and Marx refers to such people as lumpenproletariat. The stagnant part consists of marginalized people with extremely irregular employment. Stagnant pool jobs are characterized by below average pay, dangerous working conditions. They may be temporary. Those caught in the stagnant pool have jobs, so the modern definition of the employed would include both the army of labor plus the stagnant pool. However, they are constantly on the lookout for something better. The modern unemployed would refer primarily to the floating reserve, people who used to have good jobs, but are now out of work. They certainly hope that their unemployment is temporary conjunctural unemployment, but they are well aware that they could fall into the stagnant pool or the pauper class. The latent part consists of that segment of the population not yet fully integrated into capitalist production. In Marx's day, he was referring to people living off of subsistence agriculture who were looking for monetary employment in industry. In modern times, people coming from slums in developing countries where they survive largely by non-monetary means, to developed cities where they work for pay might form the latent housewives who move from unpaid to paid employment for a business could also form a part of the latent reserve. They are not unemployed, because they are not necessarily actively looking for a job, but if capital needs extra workers, it can pull them out of the latent reserve. In this sense, the latent forms a reservoir of potential workers for industries. Pauperdom is where one might end up. The homeless is the modern term for paupers. Marx calls them people who cannot adapt to capital's never-ending change. For Karl Marx, the sphere of pauperism, including those still able to work, orphans and pauper children, and the demoralized and ragged or unable to work as a mode of production. Further information, mode of production in Karl Marx's Critique of Political Economy and subsequent Marxian analyses. The capitalist mode of production refers to the systems of organizing production and distribution within capitalist societies. Private money making in various forms, renting, banking, merchant trade, production for profit, etc., preceded the development of the capitalist mode of production. As such, the capitalist mode of production proper, based on wage labor and private ownership of the means of production, and on industrial technology, began to grow rapidly in Western Europe from the Industrial Revolution, later extending to most of the world. The term capitalist mode of production is defined by private ownership of the means of production, extraction of surplus value by the owning class for the purpose of capital accumulation, wage-based labor, and, at least as far as commodities are concerned, being market-based. Capitalism in the form of money-making activity has existed in the shape of merchants and money lenders who acted as intermediaries between consumers and producers, engaging in simple commodity production, hence the reference to merchant capitalism. Since the beginnings of civilization, what is specific about the capitalist mode of production is that most of the inputs and outputs of production are supplied through the market, i.e. they are commodities, and essentially all production is in this mode. For example, in flourishing feudalism, most or all of the factors of production, including labor, are owned by the feudal ruling class outright, and the products may also be consumed without a market of any kind. It is production for use within the feudal social unit and for limited trade. This has the important consequence that the whole organization of the production process is reshaped and reorganized to conform with economic rationality as bounded by capitalism, which is expressed in price relationships between inputs and outputs, wages, non-labor factor costs, sales, profits, rather than the larger rational context faced by society overall. That is, the whole process is organized and reshaped in order to conform to commercial logic. Essentially, capital accumulation comes to define economic rationality in capitalist production. A society, region, or nation is capitalist if the predominant source of incomes and products being distributed is capitalist activity. Even so, this does not yet mean necessarily that the capitalist mode of production is dominant in that society. Wage labor, main article, wage labor, an industrial worker amidst heavy steel semi-products. Kinex bearings, Bitcha, Slovakia, c. 1995-2000. Wage labor refers to the sale of labor under a formal or informal employment contract to an employer. These transactions usually occur in a labor market where wages are market-determined. Individuals who possess and supply financial capital or labor to productive ventures often become owners, either jointly as shareholders or individually. In Marxist economics, these owners of the means of production and suppliers of capital are generally called capitalists. The description of the role of the capitalist has shifted, first referring to a useless intermediary between producers to an employer of producers, and eventually came to refer to owners of the means of production. Labor includes all physical and mental human resources, including entrepreneurial capacity and management skills, which are needed to produce products and services. Production is the act of making goods or services by applying labor power. Critics of the capitalist mode of production see wage labor as a major, if not defining, aspect of hierarchical industrial systems. Most opponents of the institution support worker self-management and economic democracy as alternatives to both wage labor and to capitalism, while most opponents of wage labor blame the capitalist owners of the means of production for its existence. Most anarchists and other libertarian socialists also hold the state as equally responsible, as it exists as a tool utilized by capitalists to subsidize themselves and protect the institution of private ownership of the means of production. As some opponents of wage labor take influence from Marxist propositions, many are opposed to private property, but maintain respect for personal property types. The most common form of wage labor currently is ordinary direct, or full-time, employment, in which a free worker sells his or her labor for an indeterminate time, from a few years to the entire career of the worker, in return for a money wage or salary and a continuing relationship with the employer, which it does not in general offer contractors or other irregular staff. However, wage labor takes many other forms, and explicit as opposed to implicit, i.e. conditioned by local labor and tax law contracts, are not uncommon. Economic history shows a great variety of ways in which labor is traded and exchanged. The differences show up in the form of employment status. A worker could be employed full-time, part-time, or on a casual basis. He or she could be employed, for example, temporarily for a specific project only, or on a permanent basis. Part-time wage labor could combine with part-time self-employment. The worker could be employed also as an apprentice. Civil legal status. The worker could, for example, be a free citizen, an indentured laborer, the subject of forced labor, including some prison or army labor. A worker could be assigned by the political authorities to a task. They could be a semi-slave or a serf bound to the land, who is hired out part of the time, so the labor might be performed on a more or less voluntary basis, or on a more or less involuntary basis, in which there are many gradations. Method of payment, remuneration or compensation. The work done could be paid in cash, a money wage, or in kind through receiving goods and or services, or in the form of piece rates, where the wage is directly dependent on how much the worker produces. In some cases, the worker might be paid in the form of credit used to buy goods and services, or in the form of stock options or shares. In an enterprise method of hiring, the worker might engage in a labor contract on his or her own initiative, or he or she might hire out their labor as part of a group, but he or she may also hire out their labor via an intermediary such as an employment agency to a third party. In this case, he or she is paid by the intermediary, but works for a third party which pays the intermediary. In some cases, labor is subcontracted several times, with several intermediaries. Another possibility is that the worker is assigned or posted to a job by a political authority, or that an agency hires out a worker to an enterprise together with means of production. Comparison to slavery. Main article, wage slavery. Pinkerton guards escort strikebreakers in Buchtel, Ohio, 1884. Wage labor has long been compared to slavery. As a result, the phrase wage slavery is often utilized as a pejorative for wage labor. Similarly, advocates of slavery looked upon the comparative evils of slave society and of free society, of slavery to human masters and slavery to capital, and proceeded to argue that wage slavery was actually worse than chattel slavery. Slavery apologists like George Fitzhugh contended that workers only accepted wage labor with the passage of time, as they became familiarized and inattentive to the infected social atmosphere they continually inhale. Scholars have debated the exact relationship between wage labor, slavery, and capitalism at length, especially for the antebellum United States. Similarities between wage labor and slavery were noted as early as Cicero in ancient Rome. With the advent of the Industrial Revolution, thinkers such as Proudhon and Marx elaborated the comparison between wage labor and slavery in the context of a critique of societal property not intended for active personal use, while Luddites emphasized the dehumanization brought about by machines before the American Civil War. Southern defenders of African American slavery invoked the concept of wage slavery to favorably compare the condition of their slaves to workers in the North. The United States abolished slavery during the Civil War, but labor union activists found the metaphor useful. According to Lawrence Glickman, in the Gilded Age, references abounded in the labor press, and it is hard to find a speech by a labor leader without the phrase. The slave, together with his labor power, was sold to his owner once for all. The laborer, on the other hand, sells his very self, and that by fractions he to the capitalist class, and it is for him to find a buyer in this capitalist class. Karl Marx. According to Noam Chomsky, analysis of the psychological implications of wage slavery goes back to the Enlightenment era in his 1791 book On the Limits of State Action. Classical liberal thinker Wilhelm von Humboldt explained how whatever does not spring from a man's free choice, or is only the result of instruction and guidance, does not enter into his very nature. He does not perform it with truly human energies, but merely with mechanical exactness. And so when the laborer works under external control, we may admire what he does, but we despise what he is. Both the Milgram and Stanford experiments have been found useful in the psychological study of wage-based workplace relations. Additionally, as per anthropologist David Greber, the earliest wage labor contracts we know about were in fact contracts for the rental of chattel slaves. Usually the owner would receive a share of the money, and the slave, another, with which to maintain his or her living expenses. Such arrangements, according to Greber, were quite common in New World slavery as well, whether in the United States or Brazil. C.L.R. James argued in The Black Jacobins that most of the techniques of human organization employed on factory workers during the Industrial Revolution were first developed on slave plantations. Girl pulling a coal tub in mine. From official report of the British Parliamentary Commission in the mid-19th century, some anti-capitalist thinkers claim that the elite maintain wage slavery and a divided working class through their influence over the media and entertainment industry, educational institutions, unjust laws, nationalist and corporate propaganda, pressures and incentives to internalize values serviceable to the power structure, state violence, fear of unemployment, and a historical legacy of exploitation and profit accumulation, transfer under prior systems, which shaped the development of economic theory. Adam Smith noted that employers often conspire together to keep wages low. The interest of the dealers in any particular branch of trade or manufactures is always in some respects different from, and even opposite to, that of the public, have generally an interest to deceive and even to oppress the public. We rarely hear, it has been said, of the combinations of masters, though frequently of those of workmen, but whoever imagines, upon this account, that masters rarely combine, is as ignorant of the world as of the subject. Masters are always and everywhere in a sort of tacit, but constant and uniform combination, not to raise the wages of labor above their actual rate. It is not, however, difficult to foresee Which of the two parties must, upon all ordinary occasions, have the advantage in the dispute, and force the other into a compliance with their terms? Aristotle made the statement, "The citizens must not live a mechanic or a mercantile life, for such a life is ignoble and inimical to virtue, nor yet must those who are to be citizens in the best state be tillers of the soil, for leisure is needed both for the development of virtue and for active participation in politics," often paraphrased as, "All paid jobs absorb and degrade the mind." Cicero wrote in 44 BC that, "Vulgar are the means of livelihood of all hired workmen whom we pay for mere manual labor, not for artistic skill, for in their case the very wage they receive is a pledge of their slavery." Somewhat similar criticisms have also been expressed by some proponents of liberalism, like Henry George, Silvio Gesell and Thomas Paine, as well as the distributist school of thought within the Roman Catholic Church to Marxist and anarchist thinkers like Bakunin and Kropotkin. Wage slavery was a class condition in place due to the existence of private property and the state. This class situation rested primarily on the existence of property not intended for active use, the concentration of ownership in few hands, the lack of direct access by workers to the means of production and consumption goods. The perpetuation of a reserve army of unemployed workers for Marxists, labor as commodity, which is how they regard wage labor, provides a fundamental point of attack against capitalism. It can be persuasively argued, noted one concerned philosopher, that the conception of the worker's labor as a commodity confirms Marx's stigmatization of the wage system of private capitalism as wage slavery, that is, as an instrument of the capitalists for reducing the worker's condition to that of a slave, if not below it. That this objection is fundamental follows immediately from Marx's conclusion that wage labor is the very foundation of capitalism. Without a class dependent on wages, the moment individuals confront each other as free persons, there can be no production of surplus value. Without the production of surplus value, there can be no capitalist production, and hence no capital and no capitalist. Systemic weaknesses, externalities, main articles, externality and commons. Market failure occurs when an externality is present, and a market will often either underproduce a product with a positive externalization or overproduce a product that generates a negative externalization. Air pollution, for instance, is a negative externalization that cannot be easily incorporated into markets, as the world's air is not owned and then sold for use to polluters. So, too much pollution could be emitted and people not involved in the production pay the cost of the pollution instead of the firm that initially emitted the air pollution. Critics of market failure theory, like Ronald Coase, Harold Demsetz, and James M. Buchanan, argue that government programs and policies also fall short of absolute perfection. Market failures are often small, and government failures are sometimes large. It is therefore the case that imperfect markets are often better than imperfect governmental alternatives. While all nations currently have some kind of market regulations, the desirable degree of regulation is disputed. Anti-competitive practices. Main article, anti-competitive practices. Further information, competition law. The doctrine of free competition is essential to the functioning of a capitalist economy, and as such, anti-competitive behavior in the market poses a crucial weakness in capitalist economics. Issues such as monopolistic behavior on the part of corporations, and aspects of intellectual property laws pose problems to capitalist economies. A prime example in the United States was Standard Oil capital accumulation. Main article, capital accumulation. Further information, money. The accumulation of capital refers to the process of making money, or growing an initial sum of money through investment in production. Capitalism is based around the accumulation of capital, whereby financial capital is invested in order to make a profit and then reinvested into further production in a continuous process of accumulation in Marxian economic theory. This dynamic is called the law of value. Capital accumulation forms the basis of capitalism, where economic activity is structured around the accumulation of capital, defined as investment in order to realize a financial profit. In this context, capital is defined as money or a financial asset invested for the purpose of making more money, whether in the form of profit, rent, interest, royalties, capital gain, or some other kind of return. In economics, accounting, and Marxian economics, capital accumulation is often equated with investment of profit, income, or savings, especially in real capital goods. The concentration and centralization of capital are two of the results of such accumulation. In modern macroeconomics and econometrics, the phrase capital formation is often used in preference to accumulation, though the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development (UNCTAD) refers nowadays to accumulation. The phrase is occasionally used in national accounts. Background. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this.